Hey guys, so today we have another episode in this series for the Chrysler Sebring. There will be many more episodes on the other Chryslers and Dodges. I do see your comments, and I do want to get to a lot of those videos when I can. But if you're new to this channel, this is a series I do where I look back at the history of the car and all the details and specs, and then we jump to talking about the events that led to the car being cancelled, and the flaws that it had. So let's get into this episode for the Sebring. Just like the last episode where I did the Dodge Dakota, this video will be slightly different and longer than the other models due to its long life through three generations, as it had three convertibles, two coupes, and two sedans. So for each gen in the history portion, I'll look at an overview, all the trim levels and specs, the original pricing, exterior, interior, and then look at the performance and engines. So I'll do that for all three gens, and then we'll look at the flaws and reasons for cancellation after. And if you want to skip to any part, I'll put the times in the description below. The Sebring did have a long life, with the first generation from 1995 to 2000, the second from 2001 to 2006, and the third and final from 07 to 2010. For the first gen, the Sebring was introduced as a coupe in 1995, and a convertible in 1996, which would replace the Chrysler LeBaron convertible and coupe models. The convertible was built off the JA platform that was used for the Chrysler Cirrus sedan, and the coupe was based off of the Mitsubishi Galant platform. Overseas models got the name Chrysler Stratus. The Sebring nameplate was brought back for the first time since it was used on the Plymouth Satellite coupe models in the 1970s, and it was also named after the Sebring International Raceway in Florida, which hosts an annual endurance race called 12 Hours of Sebring. So let's look at the first gen coupe first. Introduced for the 1995 model year, it had seating for five and it was thought to be one of the bigger and more roomy coupes on the market, with trunk capacity that could rival other midsize cars, not just coupes. The coupe was based on the four-door Mitsubishi Galant platform, however these cars do share many parts with the Eagle Talon as well, like the dash and instrument panels, and some suspension and steering components. It was also very similar to the Dodge Avenger, but it did have some notable differences, such as a much softer suspension. The first Sebring coupes had a non-functional crosshair grille, while the bottom half of the bumper was designed to take in some airflow. 1997 and up models got a bit of a facelift, with a larger black grid-style grille, ribbed accents along the lower body, different wheels, and they were also the first cars to use the Chrysler wing logo, as you'll see on the grille. There were only two trim levels offered, the LX, which started at around $15,000 in 1995, and rose up to close to $20,000 by 2000, and the LXI, which came in at $19,000 in 1995, and around $22,000 by 2000. Some of the standard features on the coupes included four-wheel disc brakes with ABS, adaptive transmissions, and fully independent suspensions. The more premium features, which either cost extra or were found on the LXI models, included variable speed rack and pinion steering, four-wheel double wishbone suspension, 17-inch alloy wheels with Goodyear Eagle tires, one-touch power windows and moonroof, and accessory delay ignition. The convertible got released 1 year after the coupe for the 1996 model year. The original plan here was to update the existing LeBaron convertible, but the midsize JA platform was chosen instead as the base, so this ended up with a compact car, while most of the other competitors in this segment had a subcompact. The approach was different than the LeBaron convertible, which had been rushed and originally built as a coupe. For the Sebring convertible, it was built at a lower cost, with less weight, better reliability, and better cornering, and that's why it wasn't just made as a coupe with the roof cut off. It actually didn't share any sheet metal with the coupe at all, and it was based on the Chrysler Cirrus sedan, as I mentioned. From the approval to the first production car, the convertible project cost only $200 million, and it took just 29 months. Again, here we found two trim levels, this time the base JX and the premium JXI. These were more expensive than the coupe, as you'll see on screen, starting at around $19,000 and topping out close to $27,000. Standard features here included dual airbags, air conditioning, power windows and top, six-speaker cassette stereo, and armrests. The Sebring convertible won the Strategic Vision's Total Quality Award in its class from 1997 to 1999, and this car got many favorable reviews, as many found the Sebring to have a smooth, cushioned ride without giving up road feel, it had a roomy interior, and there were attractive controls inside the cabin when compared to the competition. If you do want even more details, make sure to pause the screen now to see all the various updates that were added for the Sebring convertible each year from 1997 to 2000. For both the coupe and convertible, a Mitsubishi 2.5-liter V6 was the only engine available at launch, with 168 horsepower and 170 pound-feet of torque. A 2.4-liter four-cylinder was added with 150 horsepower and 167 pound-feet of torque, and either engine was paired to the 4.1TE four-speed automatic transmission. Gas mileage was similar for both, 20 city and 29 highway for the V6, and 21 city and 29 highway for the 4-cylinder. On the convertible only, some models in Mexico actually got a rare turbocharged 2.4-liter dual overhead cam inline-4 engine as well as the other two. Performance is shown on screen. While it wasn't anything to write home about, it was still somewhat decent, with the coupe hitting 0-60 in 8.5 seconds, and the quarter mile in 16.4 seconds, and the convertible being a bit slower than that. Now let's move on to the second generation, which had models from 2001 to 2006. Chrysler made things even more confusing here, using the Sebring name for three vehicles, a sedan, coupe, and convertible. The coupe was based on the third generation Mitsubishi Eclipse, and the sedan and convertible were based on the Chrysler JR platform, which was now made up of the Dodge Stratus and these Sebrings. So the Chrysler Cirrus essentially became the Sebring sedan and convertible. In fact, outside of the United States and Canada, the Sebring was still sold as the Chrysler Cirrus, and once again, that Cirrus got Chrysler's turbocharged 2.4-liter engine in other markets such as Mexico. All Sebring models got sporty new exterior styling with smooth lines, and even though all three have the same body style, they do have some different engineering details. The sedan and convertible use similar chassis and suspension elements, while the coupe shares most of its components with the Dodge Stratus coupe. Both the coupe and convertible were actually quite different, sharing just the front fascia and the interior. Again, we see here that the convertible is not just a sedan or coupe with the roof chopped off, but it was built from the very beginning to function as a convertible. The shape of the 2001 to 2003 Sebring coupe and convertible models are dominated by an elongated hood and a cantilevered windshield that rises at a very sharp angle. These early models had the signature Chrysler wing logo directly above an oval black grid-style grille. The headlights are narrow and wrap around the fenders, while large round fog lights can be found on either side of the grille. The side panels have small flares around the wheel wells, while the rear gets a tiny spoiler lip that extends to the large corner taillights. The coupe has a roof with an arching profile, which gives the car a very oval-shaped look. And the coupe got a minor facelift for 2003, while the convertible got one for 2004. As you might be able to tell in the pictures, the major changes were to the front end, where the Chrysler logo was now in the top portion of the grille, and the grille got a bit smaller and more oval-shaped. Overall, Chrysler did redesign the front and rear fascias, headlights and taillights, and side sill moldings. Chrysler always likes to confuse people with their trim levels, so I've tried to summarize them as best as I could on screen. They started with LX and LXI for all three, and then they moved into trim levels such as base, limited, and touring towards the end of the generation. Pricing began around $18,000 for the sedan, $20,000 for the coupe, and $24,000 for the convertible for the first year in 2001, and by 2005, prices had gone up by about $2,000. To take a deeper look at some of the lineup options, I chose 2002 as an example, but here are the standard features and then also the optional ones with the extra cost for each trim level I could find. So if you do want to take an in-depth look, just pause the video on those slides. As for the sedan, Chrysler took the Cirrus chassis with a 108-inch wheelbase, but they made the new body longer, taller, and stiffer, giving it a more rigid construction to resist twisting and bending. It does have a very coupe-like look, and sometimes if you don't look close enough, you can mistake it for a two-door, especially with blackened center roof pillars. The roof also flows very smoothly into the body. The sedan got a facelift in 2004, with a redesigned front fascia, new grille, and scalloped headlights. Overall, Chrysler definitely did a good job in keeping a consistent design between all the three models. As for the Sebring interior, it actually looked quite decent and was a nice place to be no matter if you were in the sedan, coupe, or convertible. It was a very expansive space, with many complimenting how roomy it was, and it had lots of stylish design elements. Depending on the model, that could mean leather, chrome, or glossy simulated walnut wood. The designers were also able to increase the length and the width of the cabin. For 2001 on all the models, the bucket seats came with cloth fabric on the LX, leather trim on the LXI, and the convertible limited models had softer premium leather trim. The dashboard has four round analog gauges with white on black graphics on the LX and LXI for all the models, and there was black on white gauges with electroluminescent lighting on the limited convertible models. An available display on the dash provides the driver with information such as temperature, trip mileage, fuel economy, and distance to empty. The center stack has the shift lever and padded armrest, and all the controls are very simple with rotary dials. Base models got features like air conditioning and power windows, mirrors, and door locks, while the higher trim levels got a leather-wrapped steering wheel and a premium sound system with a cassette deck and a CD player. In the sedan and convertible, there are rear bench seats that are split 60-40 and they fold down for extra storage. Unlike some of the other convertibles, in the Sebring, the backseat gives you enough room for two adults to sit comfortably, with three-point seat belts and two cup holders in the floor console. The front seat backs can be folded and slide forward for easy backseat access, and the seat belts won't be in the way since they are integrated into the front seats. And the trunk space is also solid for a convertible, as Chrysler said you can fit two golf bags stacked together. As for the top, it's easy to operate with two latches above the sun visor, and then one button that you have to hold on the dashboard. The coupe model's got a bit of a different interior from the sedan and convertible. Here the focus is more on sporty rather than luxury. So the coupe models don't have much rear seat space, and getting in and out is harder because the front seat does not automatically slide forward when it's flipped down. And the coupe trunk also has a fairly small opening. Moving on to performance, this time around there were three engines and two transmissions offered. On the sedan and convertible, the base engine was a 2.4-liter four-cylinder that was carried over from Gen 1, with 150 horsepower, 167 pound-feet of torque, and a 4-speed auto. There's also the optional 2.7-liter V6 for those two, with 200 horsepower and 190 pound-feet of torque. You could option to get auto stick for the automatic, or a 5-speed manual transmission instead. The coupe models also had the base 4-cylinder, but instead of the 2.7, they got a 3-liter V6 optional instead, with 200 horsepower and 205 pound-feet of torque. As for performance times, using the 2006 models, the base convertibles and sedans with the 2.4-liter engine could do 0-60 in around 10 seconds, while the more powerful 2.7-liter V6 convertible could do 0-60 in the mid-8s, and the quarter mile in the mid-16s, while the sedan with the V6 was just a bit faster than that. For some extra info on the Sebring across the globe, the sedan and convertible were exported for the European market. There were several changes in order to adhere to the European standards, like front and rear lights, rear bumper, rear fog lights, and different speedometers. The trim levels were quite similar. The European models did get a 2-liter inline 4-cylinder that the US did not get, along with the 2.4 and 2.7 engines, and the same 4-speed auto and 5-speed manual. Chrysler never ended up building a proper Euro-spec Sebring with right-hand drive and a diesel engine, so these cars never made it to the UK or Ireland, but several convertibles were imported there from either the US or Germany. Another cool bit of info that I found was that the license and assembly line for the second-gen Sebring sedan was sold to a Russian company called GAZ in 2006 for a whopping $151 million US. That company would modify the car and release it as a Volga Cyber in Russia for 2009 and 2010, but they sold just 9,000 vehicles, and that got cancelled real quick. The Sebring coupe would get discontinued for good after 2005, and the convertible and sedan lived on through 2006, before the generation ended. So now let's move on to the third gen, where the Sebring got a new model based on the GENS platform, which was a compact car platform co-developed and shared by Mitsubishi Motors and Daimler Chrysler. This Sebring was built in Sterling Heights, Michigan, using 82% of the parts from North America. As I said, the coupe was cancelled in 2005, so the sedan arrived in 2007, but the 2006 Sebring convertible was still being sold at the same time until the third gen one arrived in 2008. This Sebring found itself in a hyper-competitive market alongside vehicles such as the Chevrolet Malibu, Ford Fusion, Honda Accord, Toyota Camry, Nissan Altima, and many others. To try to make their car better, Chrysler added a third engine, a new look, a new interior, and some other details. As for the convertible, it was introduced in 2008, as I said, with a similar redesign as the sedan version. It was successful, placing second only to the Ford Mustang convertible for the best-selling four-seater open-top car in the USA. The convertible offered a retractable hardtop and softtop as well, manufactured by Karmann, and the tops could be retracted with the remote or from a button inside. Moving on to the trim levels and prices, the base models were the LX, starting around $19,000 for the sedan and $26,000 for the convertible. Touring was the second trim level, and Limited was the top, coming in near the $30,000 mark for the sedan and close to $33,000 for the convertible. The sedan also offered all-wheel drive for the Limited for just 2008, at a cost of $4,000 extra. As always, the standard and optional features are going to be shown on screen right now for the different models, if you do want to pause the video. For the exterior look, Chrysler didn't keep much from the previous generation. Styling cues were taken from the 2003 Chrysler Airflight concept, as well as the Chrysler Crossfire. The front end still has the trademark grille, but that is now smaller and higher up on the bumper. The lower part of the bumper has a few functional intakes to get cooling air to the engine. Most noticeable to me are the hood stakes, which are taken directly from the Crossfire design, but those were removed in 2010. A long hood and roofline stretch out the car visually, so you can easily tell that it's a sedan. The side has character lines running across the doors to the fenders, with optional body color door moldings to prevent dings. Moving towards the back, now the taillights are in two pieces, as they are integrated into both the rear fender and extend into the deck lid. There's also a micro spoiler lip at the edge of the trunk lid, and dual chrome exhaust tips on the higher end models. The inside also got a dramatic change, remodeled and updated to be more sleek and polished for the passengers inside. Again, little carries over from the 06 models. All the Sebring models feature a two-tone theme with shades of pastel slate gray or pastel pebble beige, and the limited model has a cream color as well. Materials and accents include tortoise shell, satin silver, alloy silver, and chrome. The dashboard is less cluttered, as all the driver info is now found in three pods instead of four. The center stack has all your controls, the Chrysler clock, and the optional MyGig multimedia infotainment system, which flows directly down into the center console and middle storage bin. The rear cup holder can be optioned out to heat your beverage to 140 degrees Fahrenheit or cool it down to just 35 degrees. The front seats are comfortable with soft and wide bolsters, the passenger seat can fold flat as an option, and the rear seats fold 60-40. Other optional features include a rear seat video system and voice-activated navigation and audio. The downsides of this interior are the large amounts of cheap plastics used and the lack of room inside for the class. So the trunk got 15% smaller from the 06 models, and only the Honda Accord Hybrid had less room in the trunk. The front and rear hip room and the rear seat leg room were also the smallest behind every car except for the Saturn Aura in the class. Moving on to performance, a new 2.4-liter world engine with variable valve timing replaced the older one, and this one had a 13% increase in power, up to 172 horsepower and 166 pound-feet of torque, and it also had 4% better fuel economy than the last 4-cylinder engine. There's also an enhanced 2.7-liter V6 that is now capable of running on E85. That has 190 horsepower and 190 pound-feet of torque. Both those engines are mated to a 4-speed auto. The top choice here was the 3.5-liter V6 engine with 235 horsepower and 232 pound-feet of torque, and that was paired with Chrysler's first ever 6-speed automatic transmission with auto-stick. The 2008 all-wheel drive model could also only be had with the 3.5. This time around, Chrysler did offer a 2-liter turbo diesel that was made by Volkswagen for global markets with 140 horsepower and 236 pound-feet of torque. Performance times are going to be shown on screen, and this time the Sebring was sold in right-hand drive in the UK and Ireland, and it was also produced for other markets such as China and Australia. As for the reasons for cancellation, or for the change into the 200, I've come up with 5 different things. I always like to talk about sales on the list, and clearly there was a huge drop in sales for the third generation. The Sebring had sold pretty well up until 2005, and then the sales started to fluctuate and really dropped off after 2008, with just under 69,000 total from 2009 to 2011 combined. The Sebring just became a car that nobody wanted. Chrysler had changed up the car in 2007 to stay relevant to the competition, but again, as we often saw during this era, they were just good enough, but not great in any category, and they had no real reason to draw buyers into the sedan. Other reasons to explain the drop in sales are due to the fact that this car took a lot of criticism. Buyers and critics just didn't think this car was as good as the previous generation, and Chrysler had cut many costs. Their switch from convertible top manufacturer ASC to Karmann caused many issues, as the tops were poorly made, and after a few years, many just didn't work. Many people hated the styling of the hood with those stakes, and it took Chrysler 4 years to finally remove them for 2010. The interior was the same old cheap, boring, hard, gray, and plastic as every other Chrysler from this era, and as I mentioned earlier, the trunk and rear seat room was almost the worst in its class. Many drivers coming over from the first gen Cirrus or Sebring felt that this car had a dead feel when driving, as those cars were tuned for the driver to feel more connected with the car. So overall, what was once a very appealing car had begun to lose that over time. Another thing worth mentioning is the poor reliability of the 2.7-liter V6, which was more of a cross-platform failure, but it did affect the Sebring. The engine had been enhanced for the third generation to be more reliable, but even after that, there were horror stories that never ended. Buildup of oil sludge is a common issue that plagues these engines, due to an insufficient oil capacity, and the timing chain-driven water pump leaking into the crankcase as well. This oil sludge issue didn't affect every engine, but it could cause complete failure. Missed or late oil changes also proved to be dangerous on this engine and caused premature failure there. And there were also problems with premature timing chain tensioner failure. Another common issue was the water pump gasket leaking coolant internally, which diluted the oil, and those leaks would also cause engine failure. I know these things didn't just affect the Sebring, but after a quick search I found many people complaining about their Sebring 2.7, and I just wasn't surprised. There were also 5 separate class action lawsuits in New Jersey regarding the oil sludge defects, and this poor reliability helped the Sebring develop a very unreliable nameplate over the years. As we talked about a bit in the second gen, Chrysler did export the Sebring sedan and convertible to Europe, and I noticed Chrysler screwed up with that move. It's not as big of a deal to make a mistake overseas, but I just think there was potential for the Sebring to do well in the European markets and make Chrysler more money, which could be invested back into the vehicle for the future. All the 2001 to 2006 Sebring sedans and convertibles were made in left-hand drive only, so they were unable to be sold in the UK and Ireland. Chrysler also failed to give the Sebring a diesel engine option, so it was never a true European model, unlike other Chryslers, such as the PT Cruiser and Voyager. Even the Chrysler 300 would later get right-hand drive and a diesel engine. It really doesn't make much sense for Chrysler to try and enter Europe without having a full Euro-spec car, and it kind of seems like they half-assed it, and I'm not sure why they even bothered. They later would have a diesel and right-hand drive for the third gen, but it was too late by then. The result was just 30,148 sales across Europe over 10 years. The final reason is that Chrysler wanted to get away from the Sebring name and just try to rework it as something else. This was actually a pretty good move, as they renamed the Sebring the Chrysler 200, and as I mentioned earlier, it did keep the same platform and body shell. Almost everything else was re-engineered, such as new body panels, grille, front and rear lights, the interior, and the powertrain. This project worked for Chrysler, as the 200 sold very well early on, well into the hundreds of thousands. Car website Edmunds.com also credits the move, saying, quote, "By changing the name, Chrysler was able to let its midsize offering ride the coattails of the Chrysler 300 and to encourage consumers to think of the 200 as the younger brother of the flagship 300. It also has the added benefit of distancing itself from its predecessor, a vehicle notorious for quality issues and fleet pervasiveness." End quote. So that's the end of this video, guys. Thanks for watching and hopefully you enjoyed it. Sorry for the much longer video, but I tried my best to give you guys as much information as I possibly could. What do you think about the Sebring? Let me know in the comments section below. Make sure to like and subscribe for more Mopar content, and I'll see you in the next video.